I'm Stephanie Kahn, and this is Friend of a Friend. I have a lot of creative friends, and they do things like play music, or they make art, or, as I like to say, they make beautiful lives. So I started this podcast so I could introduce them to some of you. In this episode, my guest is a musician that any of you would be lucky to hear, let alone play with. He plays pluck instruments like lute, arch lute, baroque guitar. He's a teacher, an ensemble leader, and a scholar. It's Sylvain Bergeron. That was Sylvain Bergeron playing a toccata in G minor from the lute book of Giuseppe Antonio Doni, and that's on the Atma label. Sylvain and I first met around 1993 in rehearsals for a Tafel Musik concert. I was in the choir, and he was a guest musician in the orchestra. We were all struck by the beauty of his playing, and he clearly had an amazing background of knowledge about playing that repertoire of music from before 1800. Luckily, our paths have crossed many times since then. Sylvain's originally from Quebec City, but he's been living in Montreal for a long time now. He co-founded the group La Nef, a creative, vibrant early music ensemble, but he's also played with so many other groups. I mentioned Tafel Musik, but also Les Violons du Roi, Apollo's Fire, the Orchestra of St. Luke's, and so many around Montreal, too many to list. Sylvain has played on more than 90 recordings now, and I'm sure it's thousands of concerts. And I think I can say his playing has really raised the standards for these instruments in Canada, where he used to be one of the few lute players in Quebec anyway. He's also down to earth and great company. Sylvain, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you. It's so nice.
It's funny we're doing this on Zoom after the years of COVID, because previously we used to see each other, I'd say right, once a year or something.
Well, this is at one least of the things that COVID changed, and probably the same for you. Like, you know, like as an artist, like concerts slowed down for a little while before the vaccine were on.
Yeah.
And that included a lot of my, you know, touring activities. So I used to come much regularly in yeah, Toronto or in Ontario, which I don't do much anymore, I think. And because, you know, reconstructing a musician's life here was also quite demanding. And it, as I said, you know, it's now almost back to normal in terms of numbers of concerts. What changed, though, is the number of people in the audience. You know, we're still like living like the counterpart of that pandemic in a way. And but it's an interesting period of time because many things change in many ways. Mm-hmm. Many artists as well. So there's good elements in that as well.
Yeah, I guess there's opportunities. People are doing interesting multimedia things, or I think we're all tired of the concert at home though, aren't we? Concert from your living
yeah,
room.
Yeah, I know. Also, like that was a kind of funny experience because all those recorded concerts without audiences, I mean, you could see like the different level of, you know, budget they had, because some of them were quite good and well prepared, and you know, with the producer that could, you know, decide where to put the cameras or spots and so on. And some other, it was the opposite. You're like, so you got everything, but what stays after that is like, I think the desire of artists to not be forgotten. You know, they want it to be still like present in people's heart, or, you know, so that big desire of being in some certain ways still present in homes was, I think, the main thing. Now that, you know, the COVID is gone or almost gone, The problem is that we created a monster, so people are getting used. I mean, they got used to stay home and get a lot of activities there. So it's a bad side of it in a way, because of course, you know, it never replaced the real thing.
No, I mean, you don't have the feedback. You can't really, you know how you do in dress rehearsal, and then the concert has, woo, it has often an electricity or just a different, it's different
It
with
is.
people.
Yeah, and what I didn't like also from those videos is that they were not, most of the time, very little contact with the video people. So you would be called for, let's say, 2 o'clock in the afternoon at Salle Bourgie, for instance, and the video crew would be there since 10 o'clock, deciding where would be their equipment and how they would stand, blah, blah, blah. But without really hearing the music yet or knowing who's doing what. So when you arrive at 2, you know, you play the concert, but with no contact, and then suddenly there's that girl that comes to you and, you know, take a big plan of your hands, and you say, "Hello, how are you?" You know, I don't know you,
Yeah,
but you're
that's a
very
bit
close.
close.
That's very close. I mean, tell me next time, maybe. So it was a kind of funny thing. And in the other hand, you know, I'm sure, I mean, those people are usually very competent, and they want to do nice images and nice sound, but the format didn't allow a lot of exchanges. And I find it a bit, you know, a bit sad because of that. And the other things that I find difficult is that it's like a CD, but just one shot for each pieces, or maybe twice. But it's like, it's so different than a recording on CD, where you have, you know, the opportunity to repeat each sections as many times as you need. So it was a kind of middle thing. So I'm glad it's kind of gone now. You know, Bernard that you know well, was saying, you know, "J'en ai marre de ces projets vidéo." It's like, you know, I cannot stand anymore those video projects. It's like,
Also, they were often free, right? People think things are free now. So,
it is, yeah, that side of it, yeah, of course.
I feel like with my introduction, I might have painted a picture of you as this very serious classical musician, which, yeah, obviously you do. But I was thinking how you're actually very free in your playing, like it's very improvisatory in places. And then I wanted to tie in that what a lot of people don't know is probably that you started out playing. Was it progressive rock or something on guitar?
Yeah, I would say maybe folk music first. When I learned kind of late, you know, by myself to play the guitar. So that was a time of groups like Jethro Tull or Pentangle, John Renbourn. So those English groups and guitarists and singers. And I was introduced to pop or progressive rock music at that time. And at the same time, my older brother Alain, which was a big, for many, many years, big buying classical music of all styles, and he knew a lot about it. He was not a musician himself, but a big music, classical music fan. So he introduced to me to actually medieval music, like, you know, those old Telefunken recordings of Thomas Binkley and those groups that started all that in Europe.
David
And
Monroe and those guys.
exactly, so that was like side by side, those two music love were the same time. So I would compose on the guitar pieces that were, you know, influenced by John Donne, for instance. And I had that group for a little while of doing a kind of mixture of both. But I must say that before all that, my interest for early music was actually interest in history, because as a young kid, I wanted to be an archaeologist. Archaeology was my, under the age of 10, I wanted to be
Indiana
Indiana Jones
Jones.
before it was invented. And so that connection of, you know, interested of discovering things of the past, kind of all connected to those two love of music. So, and eventually it became early music, and I decided to keep on in that direction since, even if most of my guitar teachers, for instance, in Quebec City, were not very encouraging. They were thinking that it won't last. I mean, you would do something else. There's no hope. There's no market. There's no music. There's no. So there was a series of no's, and that I decided to don't matter. You know, I just kept on, and it worked so well. I'm so happy to have decided to do so. So that's the way it kind of worked. You know, and part of my training was, a big part was actually as an autodidact.
Yeah, I was going to
So,
ask next, like then, were you looking up treatises and things from the beginning, or how were you teaching yourself? I mean,
yeah, well, it's both like reading. I mean, I've never been like a very big school fan, you know, like traditional schools fan. I'm part of a family where, you know, like the training and the university training is very important. And eventually today, you know, I teach at university as an instructor. But you know, in a way, I believe like it's good to do his own training. And so I kind of developed, you know, the curiosity of reading a lot. So I did a lot of my own research, yes. And I went, you know, regularly for short seminars or workshops in the States or Europe. What is usually 1 week or 2 weeks. I've never been like, you know, for years in a row in Europe, for instance. So there were like short moments where I was in contact with the, you know, masters of the lute and all that. So that really helped too. So all that together kind of helped me to figure out how to make those things work. And it's something that I encourage from students also. Like it's good to find your own way to develop those tools because there's no one ways. There are so many different ways. So find yours, you know, in a way.
Did you find like that the skills or the styles from the other genres, you brought them over to your early music playing, or did they?
Probably. I mean, like, you know, I like to improvise. So now I'm asked. I did that like for, you know, LANEF groups and like working with singers. I do a lot of recitals with singers where in which I, you know, offer to make transitions from one piece to the other. So naturally, recently I was asked by music director of Les Violons du Roi, Bernard Labadie, to do the introduction to Jephté, you know, Carissimi's Jephté, a couple of weeks ago in Quebec City in Montreal. Because the first recit of that piece is right there, you know, like it starts with the character telling the story, the first one. So it needed some kind of introduction. So I had a chance to do it 4 times. And each time people were just, oh my God, it's different each time. And I said, we call it improvisation. It's like, and you try things, but it was a nice, you know, honor to be asked to do so, like in Maison Symphonique or Palais Montcalm. So, you know, I think it's part of the things that I wanted to do with the lute is to show that, you know, it can do things. It's not just that big thing in the middle that people are curious to see but don't hear very well, or, you know, it's more than that. It's a
Is he
musical
playing?
instrument. Is he playing? Is it started? Is he still tuning? Like, for instance, like the tuning aspect, you know, maybe you remember, but I never, ever tuned on stage in my career. People don't notice that, but I made a point, you know, like when I started, because it had the lute had bad reputation. Oh, you know, half of your life you tune and the other half you play out of tune. That was the legend.
Illin pipes are like
Yeah. So I just made a point, you know, to get the instrument in good shape, ready, the frets, the strings, the pegs. I spend a lot of time, you know, I have a big variety of instruments here, but I think it's important to do so. This is something I want to communicate to students as well, you know. Other than that, you cannot just say, oh, you know, in those days they were playing out of tune, or in those days
We don't know
they were
that.
breaking strings all the time. Well, today you're not allowed.
But
Anyway.
there's so many strings on those
Yeah.
instruments.
Yeah, but you know, like harp players, they manage to do so, and very often it's more like a nervous tic, you know, like guitarists, for instance, classical guitarists, they tune a lot, but that actually what they do most of the time is they untune,
Yeah, and then they bring it
you know,
back.
and they bring it back eventually.
Maybe, yeah.
Maybe.
Oh, makes me think of that Far Side cartoon. Welcome to Hell, Maestro. And they gesture in, and it's like a room full of, I think they're banjo players in that one, but I mean, it could be guitar or lute. I guess you could change it for that.
Yeah, sure.
There's so much solo repertoire for lute, right? But
Yeah,
sorry, yeah.
it's true. You know,
So.
I was kind of looking to, you know, to the discography I've done, which is, I must say, quite a
Huge.
number.
It's
huge.
not 90, it says, but it says
Yeah, I
over
know.
90, so I don't
It's
know.
maybe 93 now, but it's like, of course, recently the recordings, everything slowed down, but there's still recordings that exist both in hard copies and streaming. So you get both, but the whole thing diminished. But still, I was probably at the right time also to do all those recordings of early music groups and a lot of labels in Canada and in the States were interested in that repertoire. So it's good to know that some people they know you through that. It's part of my legacy, I guess. It's mostly ensemble recordings because solo it's only two so far, and I'm deciding, well, it will be time in the close future to do a third one.
I
But
do
yeah.
love the Scottish one.
Yeah, the other one is more recent, is Italian,
I like it too. But the
and
Scottish one, it's I like how it has built into it. Well, I guess it's the way the suites are put together, this the old version and the new version. Like there'll be Tweed side, the old version, and then Mr. So and so, Mr. McLaughlin's version. So not only do you have the chance to play it differently every time, but you also have two transcribed ways of playing something.
But and also, well, it's good that you mentioned that because this was been so much work because there were different things. This Balcarres manuscript was kind of kept away from the main market for a while because the musicologists planned an edition that lasts like I don't know, like 15 years to do. So meanwhile, you cannot access the manuscript because it was his own thing. I got help by people that were so friendly and helpful, like Rob McAlop, that you might know, is in Scotland, and he sent me like bad copies of the microfilm. So that was difficult material to work with, and also all the titles were so badly written, and very often long titles. You get like the name of the piece with Mr. Green, or whatever. There's like four names on, above the same title. Who's who? And there were no really big articles like describing clearly that when I did the recordings. After everything went out, and I could see, oh my God, now I could have used this material. Anyway, all this to say that I keep a very nice souvenir that, but very demanding. So it was a big. That was my main archaeologist work in the last 20 years was to dig that thing.
It's so great. I think I'll play a bit of it at the end of the show after we're finished talking.
It's funny, you get help from people that like Rob was so friendly and helpful, and he's doing that, like all his research are online, feel free to
Oh,
use it, blah blah
nice.
blah. He's that kind of guy. But we see also people are so preserving their little treasures, and they're usually like not great players neither. You want to do recording of something that they don't pay honor to at all.
Oh, right. Well, that's a good point, right? There was a singer here that used to say you have to honor the bard's intention, like be faithful to the song. But then you have to fill in so much. You have to balance the two, right? Like you're inventing so much of what's there's not that much written. There's
Is
not
the
that much
case.
information in your scores, I mean.
Exactly. Yeah. It reminds me, the work we've done together also in that Gloomy Forest project
With David Greenberg.
with David Greenberg. But before that, and maybe I told you already, but that Return of the Wanderer was so, I was so jealous that Terry was playing in that and not me.
Oh, we have to revive the Gloomy Forest. I revisited it and I love so much. There's this song, Allan, that my friend got from an old Gaelic speaking man. And the way you arranged it with
It's like a loop.
the trance, like, and then Patrick Graham put these singing bowls in. It's magic. It was magical.
Thank you.
I was thinking about, despite all the solo opportunities, how you're often, well, there's an example, like with the Gloomy Forest, you're often an accompanist. Although accompanist is a misleading term, right? Because you're more a collaborator with the singer or the soloist. And I really like what I read you said in another interview. You said that you can be really sensitive and connected to singers because the instrument, I guess the lute or even archlute, allows you a proximity to a singer that a keyboard doesn't. I wonder if you could talk a little more about that relationship.
It's funny because it took a while to install that. Because at first, I remember when I showed up in Montreal like 30 years ago, of course, like keyboard instruments, piano or harpsichord were, they are well settled since many generations as the main accompanist instrument. So in the first years, like some singers were, oh, we have a lute in Montreal, so they were curious. They wanted to hear me, and oh, it's good, and blah blah blah. So that started this way, but at the same time, in different situations where for the first time you get a singer or a conductor, say, well, this one will be just with lute, and you feel like so, scared, just with lute. And then, they figure out, well, it could be nice to be just with lute. And, but, and now what I'm saying to singers is like, for instance, I like to get the singer seated just beside me on a little stool, not standing up, but just seated.
Tall, like a
And
bar stool or something.
exactly. And on the left side, don't put the singer on the right side
Oh,
because,
because you're going to look to the left to your
Your
fingerboard.
neck, your fingerboard is there, the singer is there, music is there, it's all on that side, and
Oh,
it
nice.
projects this way. And this is the best. I mean, you get exchanges more naturally than if you change the sides. So this is something that people don't figure out easily because they say, oh no, because of the neck, I don't want to be hit by the neck. So I'll be on the other side of the theorbo. Like, I never hit any singers. I never touch
You did
any.
not.
I
Okay.
never
Let it be
in
recorded on this podcast that Sylvain Bergeron has never struck a singer with his
I
board.
never
In
or got stuck in the hair of the person.
the hair, yeah. It could happen.
I know I got like big hair sometimes and curly hairs, but I
Because
pay
with the fiddle,
attention.
I'm always afraid on that side that the bow will poke me in the eye.
Yeah.
But I think it's probably for the same reason. That's the way that you are looking, right?
Yeah, usually like in a group, I like to be at the end, where is the usually the violin position.
These are all the nuts and bolts. You have to also figure out simple things like where is the best place for everyone to position. I mean, it's maybe I'm making too much of it, but it's you're saying the physical position is having an effect on your playing, basically on your
Totally,
playing
totally.
together.
Because part of the myth of the lute is, oh, we don't hear the lute. Okay, well, you don't hear the lute. First of all, how good are your ears?
You get your
Okay,
ears tested, then tell
clean your ears, come to the concert, sit at the right place, come to a nice hall. I mean, a lot of that depends on the quality of the hall. It's not the case, like in big churches, for instance, where the only thing you get is the high frequencies. So it's true that, like the venue is very important, but usually also where is your position on stage, like clarity of projection of sound. So to be in the front row, of course, and bright angle, and to know what to do also, it's very important.
I mentioned the instruments that you play. I didn't even list them all, right? Lute, baroque guitar, theorbo, archlute. And I have to say, and this is a thing that comes up a lot in my conversations with other musicians. Like, do you like practicing them? Because it feels like I feel like to be good at anything, you have to probably love practicing.
I do. I still like preparing material for, next concerts and next project. Curiously, I say no to many projects that are the schedule that doesn't allow it, or it's the kind of setup that I'm not interested to do anymore. I've done that in the past. I mean, for instance, playing with, choirs and brass, like big choir with kind of sack boots, it's not so great to do on the lute. Even there's like little moments, so
I'm glad you did it though, or we wouldn't have met.
yeah. But
I'm
but
glad you
even
used
if,
to do it.
yeah, I did that, but
It
I
was the
still do.
Monteverdi, wasn't it? I can't remember what it was, but
I thought it was Handel, but it could be
Oh,
Monteverdi.
maybe.
But yeah, I mean, at that time, I was like happy to do so, and I still love that music. But you know what changes also after a while, you become more, you know what fits you. Like, I'm happy to do that, and if I accept this other thing, I'm not sure I'm gonna be happy. So the possibility to say no to things, which is
That's
great.
kind of a luxury, and it's, but it's also for the best, as you say, things that suit you more. What are your favorite things to play right now, then?
Bach,
On which instrument, though?
the arch lute.
Ah.
Yeah, actually, I did quite a lot of St. John Passion in the last
Ah,
few years,
me.
which has a lute part, and then you could, play in many recitatives, and I was very often matched with Jesus and the Evangelist, which is like the best job ever you could
Oh,
have, like,
yeah.
and of course the soprano solos. I mean, there's so beautiful moments where you could do beautiful things on the lute. A thing that I don't do much, but I wish I could do more, is messiahs. For some reason, here in Quebec, maybe in Canada, it's usually we do organ and we do harpsichord and that's it. But there's so much moments where you could
Yeah.
do a lot on the lute and on the guitar as well, because messiah has a lot of contrast, and there's a lot of moments of all different kind of
Yeah.
styles. It's
There's
not a
even folky
church.
things like Pifa is a kind of a
Exactly, it's not
folky
a
thing.
churchy piece at all. It's like
No.
Handel is writing.
Yeah.
So it's curious because in many Handel programs, I play continuo, but for
Yeah.
Messiah, not so much. And this is one thing I want to do more in my, and I'm gonna do next season with Livionneau and La Chapelle de Québec. So
You're going to be
that,
playing on their Messiah?
yeah,
Okay. Will Bernard be
yeah.
back for that?
He,
He's getting too
he's
much
so he's
airtime in
so
this
he's
episode,
so.
but I'm just asking
He's supposed
anyway.
to. I think he really wants to do it. Of course, it's hard to predict, but yeah. So it's that kind of thing. So Handel and Bach, and especially Bach, which is so difficult to play as a solo instrument because I'm working on the cello suites at the moment. Making an adaptation for the lute is very possible, and it's still like the best music you could do. So I'm doing. With Saint Cloud's, the other orchestra that Bernard is conducting in New
That's him
York.
again. We're mentioning him again.
I know.
He'll have to, he'll be, his ears are burning here. He'll have to be a guest some other time. And then we can talk about you when he's the guest. Anyway,
Exactly.
sorry. Yeah. No, with St. Luke's, didn't you do a Bach thing with them?
Yeah, that was one of the projects that was postponed, but every June is doing a Bach festival in New York. And next June is about transcriptions. And yeah, I mean, with Bach, I just feel that you do Bach when you're a student, but you need to get back to it and start to figure out, oh my God, so much more than you thought in that music. I would be happy
Well,
to just play Bach for the rest of my life if I had the choice. That would be my first choice.
I feel we could go on for a long time about Bach and everything else, but I think we'll have to bring it to a close for now. So we're doing this on Zoom today, funny enough, but hopefully we'll be able to be COVID-free and see each other in person before too long,
Sure,
I hope. Yeah, so thank you so
sure.
much for being on the podcast.
That was a pleasure. Thanks for asking me.
Thank you.
Ciao.
That was my conversation with Sylvain Bergeron. You can find out more about his recordings, his teaching, his performances on his website, sylvain-bergeron.com, and I've spelled it out for you in the show notes. Thanks to Ellie Burcock for his music that I use as the theme. You can buy that on Bandcamp. And thanks to all of you, as always, for listening. I'm going to go out now with some music from Sylvain's recording of the Balcarres Lute Book. Bye for now. Thank you.